Okay, I think we're live, and this is the Public Law Radio Show, as heard here every Friday night from 10 to 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And don't have my GMT converter to tell you what it is on your area of the rock. However, on the internet, noborders.co.uk. Also simulcasting on Tirnasaor.com, www.tirnasaor. So, that being said, thanks for tuning in. Good to have you. Good to be here on No Borders and Tirnasaor. And this is Bo from the Bo and Rocco Show, as I'm endeared by. We've got Tammy Pepperman here as the co-host anchor of this worldwide broadcast. So, where did I leave out? That's the first time introducing the show, so I don't know if I covered all the bases or what.
Just how much we love Ben and Kev.
I'll try to speak up if you can or get a little closer to your mic.
Oops, sorry about that. Yeah, we're just so thankful to have this venue. And, of course, No Borders Radio is owned by Ben, and Tirnasaor is owned by Kev, and we thank both of them, especially for this venue and this opportunity. And so we've got a lot going on. I'll let you take the reins, because today's been a really long day for me, and I'm pretty worn out.
All right. Well, let's just ease into it. Ease in with some entertainment news. How about that?
Awesome.
Okay. Over in the entertainment section here at Xfinity, Dakota Johnson's dad, Don Johnson, says heroin should be absolutely legal. Now, apparently Dakota Johnson's dad, actor Don Johnson, who was on Miami Vice back in the day, for you that may remember that, and other various projects as an actor.
Isn't that funny?
So he has some pretty strong opinions when it comes to legalizing drugs. Now, long story light, short, he's saying that everything should just be legal and they should just tax it all, though.
Absolutely. Now, look at his purpose. Look at what he did as an actor. He was pitching back in the 80s when cocaine was really hit the scene and a lot of people were using cocaine and everything. He came in as an actor on Miami Vice and they were nailing people for what? Commercial crimes. He's the one that presented that to humanity. He's one of the ones. Of course, he's not a producer. He's not a director. He was an actor. But he's the one that sold everybody the concept of illegal drugs. The concept of going along with the program, going along with policy, and especially going along with 27 CFR 72.11, where all crimes are commercial crimes.
Yeah, the problem with the whole war on drugs situation, and it of course stems from commercial crimes, but now when the enforcement comes into play, though, as they presented on Miami Vice, the big guns come out, and it basically puts these cartels into a position where they they're almost forced into this violence and harm, you know, upon humanity when you're using guns and such. So it's the very nature of these attorneys inventing commercial crimes that forced it over into the harm upon humanity aspect of it.
Absolutely. And when you look at the concept of commercial crimes as defined by 27 CFR 72.11, you see right away that those are offenses against the laws of revenue. Well, if say you are dealing in drugs or you are kidnapping, or you are prostituting somebody. 27 CFR 72.11 says that you're undercutting the federal government. So these drug cartels, right there in their own writing, are the federal government. That's their money-making schematic. And that is where my concern comes in. Now, if they're making money on all of these things, kidnapping, prostitution, drug use, addiction to narcotics, all of these things, it's a mafia, and the mafia is charging you for undercutting them and then shooting you under the guise of legal activity for undercutting them. And they have this big scheme worked out where human beings are always the enemy of the state, because the state is the one that's cashing in on all of those things. So if you're tricking somebody out, if you're a pimp, whatever, and you're undercutting the federal government, they're going to charge you for undercutting the federal government. But that's still the action of human trafficking. It's still using human beings. The judge is cashing in. The prosecuting attorney is cashing in for charging somebody for the use of a human body. And that has to stop. But Don Johnson, I think he's trying to buy his way into heaven. It's not going to cut it. He was one of the most prolific actors indoctrinating humanity to believe that those things actually exist and they're crimes against humanity, when it never was. Those are crimes against the laws of revenue, and it's stopping now. And
yeah, and the presenting the need, you got to go shoot people because they're undercutting the government for selling stuff that comes out of the ground.
Right, and you know, I'm not advocating the use of heroin at all. I don't. That's just foul. I don't like the concept of somebody consuming something or shooting something up that harms them. But again, when you go back to the foundational aspects of what is known now as suicide, when you go back into the law and into the lexicons, it was originally called felo de se. Now, it was called felo de se because that means a felon of himself. And so if you, a fee on a farm animal, killed yourself back then when it was called felo de se, they would garner your estate by claiming that you were a felon. You took away the productive value of yourself, so they took over your estate for you because they claimed that you were a felon because you killed yourself. You took your value out of the farm, and so they were penalizing the estate, or what was left of the estate, such as your children and whatever. And it's just sick. You know, there should be no charges for use of the human body, period. Absolutely not, because the state should never cash in on your demise, which is now they're collecting death derivatives when you pass away. They're collecting on the insurance. All of these things is just, it's foul. It's absolutely foul. It's disgusting that any state, could be doing this upon humanity and for so long being allowed to do that by the citizenry, because they didn't realize what was going on. They think they're being protected, but they're actually renting each other.
Well, right along the same lines as the entertainment, over to Twitter news. Barack Obama has some 19.5 million fake Twitter followers.
Oh, I saw that. That is so funny. That's what Walter Burian found years and years ago. He found that there was a whole bunch of government agents without any title, without any department. They were just there pushing buttons. And that's an example of, you know, even more than we even realized. 1.9 million.
Yeah, right. Back then, he was saying in 2008, 2009 or so, it was 800,000.
Right.
So, apparently these 19.5 million fake Twitter accounts lead back to no real person on the other end.
Right.
So that's...
Well, and it doesn't stipulate, you know, that there's that many. I mean, a lot of... I've seen kids do that and create more than one account.
Well, I'm sure, I'm sure these agents have created multiple accounts because it's probably part of the job description.
Right. But it's funny that he's got his own fan base, but he has to pay to have his fans. It's like...
And he's taken the money out of... you know, everybody, all the citizens' coffers to do it. He's right. taking your money off you to sell you the propaganda of the Confederacy. Now, what we should point out here while we're still in the front part of the show is that the reason we can talk about this on a global scale here is because back in 1941... If you haven't heard this radio program before, because we talk about this continually, that Congress was given world dominion. That's the United States Congress was given world dominion under the Atlantic Charter, which was entered into by...
Roosevelt. Churchill.
Churchill. And so now everything that we're talking about, it applies globally because all your so-called governments that the attorneys and the media keeps telling you that you're under continually to the point where you believe it, is that they're in contract with the United States Congress to offset congressional bankruptcy by using citizens. It's a global banking schematic that the judges are following. Through their oath.
Were.
Well, right. Were. Now we've got some, got our hands in the pot here now, we should say, I guess. You want to elaborate on that? Go ahead.
Well, it's, there's a lot of exciting things, and more will... be revealed as time goes by. Matthew 6 says we're not allowed to brag or do things to be seen of man, and that's one of the biggest rules that we have during this time. But you know, it's self-evident by now.
Right. It's not
through the mainstream media.
You know, it's not the matter of us tooting our horn here. Just go read the case. The basic premise of what we've done to change the situation on the human beings end can be found at chooseyourside.org and or tammypepperman.org. Just go to the documents and read the case, because it says it all in the case. We documented all the evidence there. And
right, and we'll be updating really soon as well, because we've been doing a lot of things that are even more current that we have to kind of hold in our hands just for a moment because of the safety of not only our officers, but also of others involved in this transition. And as soon as we are guaranteed the safety of our officers and guaranteed the safety of various beings, I guess we'll just call them our beloveds, because of course they're adhering to the public law, and my function is to protect them above and beyond anything else. Humanity is forefront in our obligation, and that doesn't change ever. A lot of people don't realize what we mean when we talk about the 1941 Atlantic Charter. Now, it was Roosevelt and the Prime Minister of England at that time, Winston Churchill, that had entered into agreement to give Congress global governance and allowing Congress, the people, to choose their own form of government. Now, it's not verbally. What it was the use of mechanics. And if you can imagine, this is a huge machine. They would use the Electoral College to bring forth whatever was necessary according to market conditions. So if it was necessary to maintain a democratic market, then they would cede the Congress with a majority Democrat. If there was need for a majority Republic, then they would cede the United States Congress with the majority Republicans. And it goes back and forth, according
to... Well, it's the same thing on their end, in their local parliaments or congresses or whatever.
Right. And so you'll see this maintained globally on a global scale. So when they're maintaining a Democratic Congress, you'll see them promoting democracy over in Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan, Israel, Korea, you know, Germany, whatever. It depends on who's sitting in Congress, what majority is ruling at the time. Now, what was most profound is that since 1938, it was a Democratic Congress, always. It didn't matter who the president was. The president changed, and the president and the, which was also the vice president, and it was always the president of the Senate, of course. But the president could change. It could be a Republican president, it would be a Democratic president, whatever, but it was maintained by the seated Congress. So it would be a democracy or a republic. And we didn't see a republic come back until 2010. And that was the most interesting, because then, of course, then we start, or not we, Congress starts espousing constitutional theory again in various countries, and all of a sudden you see these constitutions laid down again, you know, but it was all maintained by this business schematic. And it doesn't matter, there is no bipartisanship, there is no separation, there's nothing. It just only depends on market conditions. And after 41, that's when everybody saw the United Kingdom replace the crown. Now, the crown was always a presentation. The queen, if you look at the dynamics of the queen and the royal family, you'll see that they're nothing but actors. They are on welfare through the House of Commons, which means that, of course, they're a commoner. They just get more money than normal commoners because they're paid actors. They're there to present the illusion that there's some kind of kingdom, but it's not a kingdom. A United Kingdom is an oxymoron.
Right. So, yeah, in light of that, then you see the recent story with Henry, Charles.
Yeah, Putin.
Calling Putin Hitler, something to that effect, and Putin, you know, lashing back, and you know, they're both in the Atlantic Charter. So what you're seeing there is a big presentation, a play, a act, a script.
Act of Congress, and that's what is the hardest for any human being or any citizen to realize, is these are all acts. They're screenwriters, script writers. That's their function. They present acts. And that is only according to market conditions. If they need to raise a certain sect of humanity, they'll just switch it up and they'll pass another act to allow that to happen, which are acts of enablement.
So, they teach you to look at government the way they want you to see it in school. So that's one of the reasons for the state-sponsored schools. And although it looks right on the surface level when you read your Magna Carta and your constitutions and all that, you got to look deeper into the treaties, which are the banking agreements that really the world runs off of. So, you know, at the end of the road, it's Rome, and they're banking on human beings.
Right. And the public school system itself is through the action of hearts and minds. So they're raising you, and they tell you that you're not good enough, whatever. So everybody's striving to get educated, but education is actually stemming from the word pedagogy, which means attendance on boys. That's how you are indoctrinated. It's always been an indoctrination schematic so that you don't see what is actually going on. I mean, public school systems are the same Hitler Youth camp. They just look prettier on the surface.
Yeah. So going back to this entertainment with Twitter, according to Twitter and Alex applications status people, 37% of Michelle Obama's 5,290,000 Twitter followers, or approximately 1.957 million followers, are considered fake. 35% of her followers are inactive, and 28% are considered good or real. So again, this is money of yours that they took from you to create the consensus reality, and it's just a scam upon scam upon scam, and it's got to stop here. We want to get down to the reality of our world, because what we're fed to by the media and the politicians is all artificial intelligence.
And you know, you go into the realm of what type of entity pays people to appear like they like him. Or like her. I mean, that's something that, it's like hanging a pork chop around a dog's neck to get it to like you and not to bite you. it's interesting. Very, very interesting.
Yeah, and they're just crafty wordsmiths is all they are, and spend 95% of their time just trying to get you to like them, just like every attorney does, or as you call them in your country, outside the of the United States, you know, commonly known as geographical location of the United States, it's the same thing, only different there, though. But
right, how many other politicians do that, and how many illusions are there that need to be done away with? How many illusions are the human beings buying into because they're just fed all of these things? You know, you see all of these likes on these YouTube presentations, and you see all these Facebook likes and Twitter retweeters and all of these things, and it adds to the consensus reality. And so, you know, if you say you see something happening and you see the evidence and their works in action, and something is bad, but then on the other side you're like, no, everybody else likes some, maybe it's just me, maybe I'm seeing something that isn't truthful. No, that's what they rely on. They rely on that cognitive dissonance to tell you that not to believe yourself and not to trust your own eyes witnessing these things occurring, and that's part of the program. But what's amazing is now this is coming to the forefront. Not only are we, you know, with the evidence that they've been, you know, perverting the election process. Elective processes aren't even human beings voting. They're actually maintained by the Electoral College, meaning that, you know, somebody is governing humanity and saying, this is what I think is best. But it's not, this is what I think is best for humanity. It is, this is what I think is best for business. It's never, ever, ever been about state security, which refers to the human being. It's always been about national security, which refers to the corporations. And it's beautiful to see all of this coming out now. I was concerned, you know, for Obama, because they're really painting him as, you know, not only a liar, for example, paying people to say they like him, but they also presented him, HBO and the White House itself, that he is associated with this King Joffrey, the Game of Thrones, and all of this type of presentation now. And my concern is that they're trying to, you know, not only out what he is, but allow for a vicious mindset. Now, under the public law, we do not promote murder. We do not promote assassination. We do not promote any type of violence. Now, Congress has claimed bankruptcy well before 1933. 1933 just happened to be the time that they actually said they were bankrupt. If you go back to 1794, the Treaty of Amity, Commerce, and Navigation, they were bankrupt then. They were bankrupt in every treaty. That's what a treaty is. It's a banking agreement to discharge congressional bankruptcy. Now, all of those things said, they are responsible for discharging their bankruptcy. And I don't want to see anybody assassinated. I don't want to see anybody harmed. I want to see them in Gitmo. I want to see them in prison. I want to see them in mental institutions. Identical, identical. It has to be the same weight and value as to what they did upon humankind. And that is what we're seeing now. But I do not want to see them assassinated. And it looks like they're posturing to do that. And that bothers me because, you know, at one point the Secret Service pinged Reagan when they paralyzed Brady to enforce the gun control. That was the Secret Service. Okay, the FBI came out and said they were the ones that assassinated Dr. Martin Luther King. Now, I don't want to see those things occur again. I want to see everybody held accountable according to their works. And death is not holding somebody accountable.
Okay, well, so, all right. Would you like to go on with the news then, or where do you want to take it from here?
Yep, go ahead. Sorry, I went off on a tangent.
Well, yeah, this stuff's important to understand, though, and, you know, our point of view is, you know, we've given a better business model, but to facilitate that business model, now they have to start extracting the wealth back the other way, because it's all been extracted out of the human beings, and to do that, we don't want to just start offing these people. So they'll be held accountable according to their works, but anyways.
Right.
I can't really add too much to that.
No, and that's, you know, I'm sure that a lot of people consider that evil or mean, but if you go back into all of history to see what Congress has actually done upon humankind, you know, you would want to peel them like a banana. And I don't want to see that happen either. I want to see them
again. Let's get them rounded up first and get all the evidence on the table.
Yep.
Not turning word product doctrine anymore, just real evidence.
Yep, and that's what's occurring in that's been the most amazing this week, is to see, you know, I've been able to rest, and
I mean, we might need to have Obama examined to make sure he's not a robot or something, you know.
Right.
Because you never know. I mean, that's out there, I know, on a limb, but just trying to emphasize the point.
Right. Psychovals all around. And that's the thing. You know, they have initiated not only courts, not only this banking schematic, they went way out there when they brought in the veterans courts, and they started facilitating psychovals on all the veterans, knowing that they were traumatized during the war times, knowing that, you know, they were biologically injured, they were biologically damaged, and they've been taking advantage of them, and that's what I want to see. I that's what's happening. You know, we cannot go into detail yet, but I mean, this is just profound. This last week on me being able to breathe and others taking up the slack, where it's just been the United States court And of course, the governor and the clerk and everything maintaining directives. And these are being followed to a T. And I'm still reeling, I think. It's actually quite surreal for me to see what's happening. And I've been... The only way to explain it is running a race and you know, because I used to run, and you get to the finish line and you keep on going, and that's what happened, you know. And for a full week or two, I just kept on going, and finally it hit me that, you know, it's time to rest now. So it's been profound, and I'm still trying to process everything that has been occurring, and it's been an amazing week. More than amazing. I don't know a word for it. Awe-striking.
Okay, so into the news here, just some general topics, and show you all the things being exposed about these criminals. Fed bailed out Canada. Prime Minister Harper caught lying. Let's see here. Canada Bank bailout. Yes, let's see, there was $114 billion in emergency lending and cash injections at the bailout's peak. The Federal Deposit Insurance Corp, the fund, has less than its required reserve ratio of 1.15% of the deposits it insures. And the FDIC expects to reach that goal by 2018.
Right, and all of that is just a lot of smoke and mirrors. If you go back to the 1978 Inspector General's Act, where that FDIC was actually, quote, created, you'll find that is not the case, because the debenture participation program is a portion of that insurance schematic. Now, somebody was asking on Skype about democracy and if people would vote for democracy. Demo means people. Kratos means to control or possess. So democratus or democratic society is to control or possess people. So you don't want to vote for that. You know, it's a control mechanism. And, you know, it's always been that control. When you're consenting to it, you're consenting, you're giving your body over to that. And, you know, again, it's up to your free will. Now, I have to say, and I keep saying we can't say too much. We can't say too much. However, everything that is occurring now, if you are still patronizing that thing, you are or could be up for grabs. And what that means is, if you are in the medical industry, in the psychological industry, in any realm consenting, that's your free will. That is your free will. You are saying that you enjoy democratic society. You enjoy being governed by another governor rather than the public law. Now, if your governor is a public law and your house adheres to the public law, then you're not up for grabs. But if you're still patronizing that thing and calling it your father, it is your father. It will give you rights and benefits, but you also are contracting to accept what it does to you in order to give you rights and benefits. And that means it's charging you, it's killing you in the medical industry, it's putting you in an institutionalized state through the psychological industry. Now, you might have it good right now with the benefits and everything, and it might feel good right now because you're medicated or whatever, but it's not going to feel good forever. And ultimately, that is what happened with Job. And I cannot say it loud enough that if you are consenting, that is your will, that is what you want, that is what you are saying in words and saying by your actions that is what you want. That means that I cannot do anything to stop anything from occurring upon you, because you are not my property, you are not your property, you are the property of the thing that you are patronizing. Now, I've said it thousands of times, and again, it's your will. This is what you're choosing. And there's nobody else that's going to pull you out. It's up to your choice, your decision. And especially if you have knowledge. There's nothing I can do for you. Now, if you're an innocent, and, you know, you don't have any knowledge of these things, absolutely, I'm going to come in and protect you. Absolutely. But if you're with knowledge and you're still patronizing that thing, that you're evidencing what you're choosing.
Okay, so all right, well, let's just get into proof in the pudding here, part of that in the news, the Iceland Review at IcelandReview.com. So this is obviously in Iceland. Nurse charged with manslaughter. Director of Public Prosecutions in Iceland is charged with Landspitali National University Hospital with a nurse working at the hospital's intensive care unit with manslaughter due to negligence after a patient in their care died in October 2012. This is the first time that the hospital and staff members are charged with manslaughter. Hospital said in a statement that the case has had a significant impact on its staff and the Icelandic healthcare is at a crossroads.
Absolutely, and it's beautiful to see.
The nurse is currently on leave of absence. The wife of the deceased patient said in an interview that she does not think it is right to charge the nurse. Well, right. Well, maybe somebody else needs to be charged higher up the food chain, because the nurse obviously is a fall guy, being a victim of policy that is dictated by the owners, that, you know, or the people that run the hospital, which are always attorneys.
Right, and that's why the hospital's being charged as well, which is beautiful. I mean, that's something that's brand new, and this continues. I mean, Holder came out and maintained that banks will be charged. It's not just going to be these actors. It's going to be the system. And, it's just, as I said, it's all striking.
So we'll put that one in the file there for the proof of the pudding. I'm going to pull up another story here. Let's see. Oh, goodness. What do you think about this? I guess this is as related as anything. Angelina Jolie has prompted many of these mastectomies now, just like we predicted it would. That was all a marketing, an advertisement to get your boobs chopped off, just to be careful, just to make sure you don't get breast cancer. And sure enough, a bunch of women fell right in there like good citizens.
Right. To the benefit of the attorneys that own the hospital and the medical industries. And it was the same thing, you know. Okay, so double mastectomies is what she was pushing, just in case. And now this is an actress, and I just can't wait till she's held accountable. And that's something that, you know, they did the same thing with the abortion industry years ago. Now, if you go back to what this does to the human body, it's absolutely horrifying. because you, the human, produces various hormones and you function as a human. When something is taken off of you, your functioning capacity as to your biology is diminished, and plus you now are producing other things that are not beneficial to life or not conducive to life. When you go back to the foundation of what an abortion does, for example, if the female body enters into pregnancy, goes through the pregnancy and has a child, the body adapts through the whole thing. That's the function of the body. Now, if you cut that short, and those very, very important hormones are not allowed to course through the body, you're shutting it off at a certain point. You're lysing let's just call it metabolism. You're lysing that mid-cycle, and after that, you're going to end up with such detrimental failure of the body later. And that's the whole point of not only the legality of abortion, it also gets rid of the female as well later. It doesn't just stop the life of a child or an infant. It stops the life and it cuts it short for the female, because she's not able to produce the hormones taking her out of pregnancy when it's cut in the middle or cut partially. It's sick what Angelina Jolie was presenting, why this is all part of the eugenics program.
Yeah, which she's been a part of for a long time, as we've seen it, her involvement with the UN. It looks good on the surface, like she's there to help children and stuff, but look a little deeper here.
Angelina Jolie is a member of the Council of Foreign Relations.
Right. So the, okay, so wrapping this story up, basically the points are women with low risk of contracting cancer are requesting the procedure. Means they're being overtreated and may suffer long-term harm. Okay, this comes right out of the, this is at the Daily Mail. Dailymail.co.uk. And they're using the words harm now, which I like to see. It's good they're finally coming around, because I'm sick and tired of hearing turning word injury. And then comes after actress Angelina Jolie last year chose a double mastectomy. So, there you go in a nutshell. If you want to read more, look over to Daily Mail. And it is absolutely just foul and disgusting. And these actors from Hollywood are just also acting for Congress or the League, the Confederacy, whatever you choose to call it. These guys are all on board together, as you can see from the Treaty of Westphalia from 1648, which we've been spending a little time on here lately too. And if you feel like there's something that you missed or left out, well, maybe it's because we just covered it recently, so go back through our archives of Tammy's show and my show, Leaving the Farm is her show, and then mine's the Bo and Rocco show, of course. Now, everybody wants to know what's going on with Rocco and stuff, so
that's part of what we're not going to talk about because of the stuff that's going on back channel. And we've been receiving communications, of course, and everything is going as directed. And
yeah, we heard from him, and he's okay. Okay, that's all really we can say at this time, but it's
Matthew 6.
It's all going to be very, it's all going to be very revealing as to, you know, the evidence that he's brought forward by putting himself into this position. You know, really, it's not even him putting himself into this position. It's just they always have been positioning him, and he just let them do what they do, so we evidenced a great many things, not least of which is that the only thing they are holding him for as evidence as a prisoner of war.
Right.
I said that already over and over again. And
again, Matthew 6. Now, I'm going to say this again. We are directed by our rules, the Word of God, and the walk of God, not to toot our own horns. We are not here to be seen of men, Matthew 6. That means that it is not likely that we are going to speak of any of this. And the reason for that, again, is it is your free will. If you want to patronize that other daddy, it's up to you. I'm not going to offer you any benefits to not patronize that other daddy. You're not going to get any candy from me. You're not going to get any gold from me. You're not going to get the big and shiny presentation from me. It's up to you. Now, invoking the ego, we don't have one. Rocco, I, Bo, and the other houses have done this on behalf of humanity. We didn't do this because we want treats. We didn't do this because we want money. We didn't do this because we want glory. We did this because we are human and we are protecting humanity. And again, we're not going to tout any of this from the hilltops.
Well, I am going to show you, you know, what the Congress, or what Tammy calls the other daddy, has got to offer you as far as benefits. So that we will talk about.
Absolutely.
So if you like that thing, here's what you can expect to find behind door number one at the Daily Sheeple, where it says wake the flock up. Veterans Affairs Supervisor, older veterans should be shot in the head to save money. Okay? Veterans Affairs whistleblower has exclusively revealed that the facility at which he works has engaged in a cover-up in response to the VA hospital scandal, while also relating the story of how one supervisor expressed his desire to see older veterans taken outside and shot in the head. Well, that just don't say it all about what they think about veterans. Okay, what's going on here is United States Incorporated is broke. All right? So the more they can take away from these veterans' benefits, more money they're going to have to keep their enterprise going. Okay, and it's not bad enough that these people were sold all this patriotism and this stack of bovine excrement about what they were fighting for, but now they come back. And their reward is this. They are also criminalizing the veterans every which way they can. They are also, you know, of course, at the same time, trying to recruit more people into the meat grinder. And now they're taking in illegal aliens because they can't get enough sign-ups from regular U.S. citizens anymore, for whatever reason.
Offering them benefits. We just saw that kidnapping case. Now, a lot of people are not aware that the Violence Against Women Act that Joseph Biden authored allows a female who's a, quote, immigrant to claim domestic violence or kidnapping or rape or whatever else. And she gets a free pass to be a citizen. That's another action of winning hearts and minds. Now, this child, when she was 15, was sold to that guy by her mother. Now, this guy is being charged with kidnapping and holding her hostage for 10 years. When in reality, she just got fed up of being married to him and having kids. And that was her way out. That's the easy way. Now, I don't see her mother being charged with child trafficking. I don't see Joseph Biden being charged for child trafficking for writing that into the Violence Against Women Act. Yet. And there's a lot of things that, you know, it's absolutely horrifying. It's absolutely abhorrent. But going back to the veterans, we have actually evidence so much. And, you know, you can find that on our YouTubes in my conversation with Patrick, a veteran that was being raised. You know, it's sad. It's really sad what this society has allowed to occur.
Yeah, now couple that with also the recent story that's come to light about how the Veterans Administration has been railroading these people that need immediate help and making them wait and wait to the point that some of them are dying before they can get in to get any help.
Right. That's and not accidental.
They are just cannibalizing these veterans like there's no tomorrow.
Because they're used. They already served a, quote, country. And that's how the business works. Once you're done, you're done. You are a good producer. This is your gold watch. And a lot of that is dying through the medical industry.
And that's what you have to look forward to if you patronize the Congress, the transgressors, the League, the Confederacy, those that are on the mutual voyage, also known, actually, as we the people, because we the people always meant them, the Congress. It never meant you, the plebeian. So keep that in mind when you hear these misguided patriots out there speaking about we the people. Because it doesn't mean you.
Right. And again, the reason for our shows recently, especially, is because we're in the circling back phase. Jesus said we're supposed to look for all lost sheep. Here we are, lost sheep. Now, if you have knowledge, you're not a lost sheep. You have knowledge, and with knowledge comes a willful choice either way. If you need further evidence, please visit chooseyourside.org. Or TammyPepperman.org. And of course, stay tuned right here on No Borders Radio, Tirnasaor, and as well as Revolution Radio, FreedomSlips.com. But, now, because Matthew 6 and related rules out of my rule book maintains that we're not to purchase you. We're not to offer you any candy or treats or reward in your face before you choose your side. Leaving the farm, the show, is going to go away. I mean, it's not like, you know, I'm tired of doing Leaving the Farm or anything. It goes away because you have the knowledge that you require to choose your side. It also goes away because of the rules. I cannot offer you, and I'm not going to come out and say, you know, what happens on a day-to-day basis. I'm not going to come out and say, look, this guy got this much or this guy got this much. That is not the purpose of my being, and my entire walk was not for glory. And if I came out and I told you what occurs and how much this guy got and how much that guy got, that's not free will. That's coming to the human ease. Then you make your decision because you want the money. That, sadly, is what Judas is and what Lucifer is, the fallen angel. He fell because he was reaching for the money. That's the story of Icarus. And it doesn't provide you with the means of entering into the kingdom of heaven, which is your kingdom. So for all of those questioning why I said what I did last week on leaving the farm, that's the reason. I can only show you the way, the two ways. There's a big, huge path, but the gate is narrow. If you choose to go wherever until you find out that you get a benefit for going one way or the other way, then that's not heaven, is it? That's not your kingdom. It's somebody else's kingdom, and you're riding along on their coattails. And that's not the rules. Those are not the rules. That is not the action of human being. A human being makes a decision consciously to not only protect family and community, but a human being protects all. And that includes all life. And I'm not going to purchase Lucifer, and I'm sure as heck not going to purchase Judas, because I know that at some point in time, Judas and Lucifer turns on him. Turns on all of humanity again, and this thing happens again and again and again. So if you're not human, if you are a psychopath, whatever, you're going to choose the other way. And that means that you're going to get rid of yourself. And I don't have to do anything about that, because your daddy's going to do that for you. And that's the overall good for humanity.
So, coming right from the VA's own website, benefits.va.gov, talking about incarcerated veterans here, which is really a good way to cancel more benefits of these veterans. The VA disability compensation payments are reduced if a veteran is convicted of a felony and in prison for more than 60 days. Veterans rated 20% or more are limited to the 10% disability rate. For veterans whose disability rating is 10%, the payment is reduced by one half. Once a veteran is released from prison, compensation payments may be reinstated based upon the severity of the service-connected disabilities at the time. Payments are not reduced for recipients participating in work release programs, residing in halfway houses, also known as residential reentry centers, or under community control. The amount of any increased compensation awarded to an incarcerated veteran that results from other than a statutory rate increase may be subject to reduction due to an incarceration pension. So, I mean, what this is all basically doing is providing an incentive for, the federal government and filtering through their corporate counsel attorneys that filter the policy down to police is to criminalize as many veterans as possible.
Right, and let me tell you how easy that is under the Violence Against Women Act that Joseph Biden authored. So a female can come in and get a restraining order against a male based on false allegations like that in a heartbeat. She can claim whatever she claims. There's a two-week window. There's 14 days of a window in there where usually what happens, thanks to coaching from domestic violence shelters, guardian ad litems, prosecuting attorneys, and all of the other attorneys that are involved in this schematic, is that the female will be coached to invite that male back into her life so that he can be violated. Now, upon violation, he gets nailed with a felony. At the 14-day mark, the judge will usually dismiss the restraining order, but leave that violation on there. It's a whole new game. So then the veteran or the average Joe has a felony mark on his record. And this is how the banking schematic is played against human beings. Now, veterans pay. It says that they don't pay out if you're a felon. That's how easy it is to criminalize a veteran and take all of that monies and put them all into the local coffers, the municipal coffers, the federal coffers. And of course, no one benefits more off of human demise than such as Joseph Biden himself, Patrick Leahy himself, and of course, you know, all of the other members of Senate and the House of Representatives that are cashing in and laughing about these things as they occur.
There's also a video over on YouTube on just another angle of the same thing, other than honorable, colon, army strips benefits of wounded veterans by kicking them out for misconduct.
Right.
So,
and that's always been the part of the game. Honorable discharge, dishonorable discharge. Somebody can be claimed or deemed AWOL if they don't come back on time the next morning, say they go out drinking or whatever. Oftentimes, it's too much, and somebody will go AWOL for a day or two because of what they've seen, what they've experienced. And at that point in time, they take everything away from that veteran, regardless of how much time he or she has put in. And that kind of thing, this is how they raise you, folks. They use you from cradle to grave and everything in between. It's very rare. People look at, you know, they see veterans benefits and they see these veterans hospitals and all of these things. The majority do not qualify for veterans pay after they get out. And it's the same tricky little slick mechanism they have with unemployment. They say, well, the unemployment rate is at 8.9%, 9.5%, 12%, 5%. Those are just the ones that stood there and did the appeals and entered into the system. There's another 90% who are actually unemployed. They don't qualify for unemployment insurance. This is the game. The presentation is all that matters. Now, the majority of veterans have walked away. They're homeless. They're starving to death. They're institutionalized in mental institutions. They're institutionalized in prisons. These are the folks that thought they were protecting human beings. It's just exactly identical to what law enforcement has been going through. They're raising their retirements. They're forcing them into early retirement so that they don't have a retirement. You know, they take a, what, 75% hit just to survive because they're forced into that by various mechanisms. And the force comes, you know, it's not just a little bit of force. They're going into foreclosure. They're losing everything. CPS is after them. Adult protection is after them. IRS is after them. Their own insurance is after them. Their own corporation is after them. Whatever it takes through fourth generation warfare is what's going to happen to every single, quote, citizen on this planet, unless everybody wakes up.
Yeah, and important to point out once again, this is all perpetuated by the attorneys.
Absolutely.
So, now, and then the other side of the coin is, you pit the non-constitutionalists against the constitutionalists, and they perpetuate the whole constitutional paradigm. Well, over here on PatriotRising.com. Gotta love that.
Another oxymoron.
That's not a CIA front or anything.
Yeah.
So what they're pushing here is, tech startup wants to replace Congress with software. Oh, doesn't that sound warm and fuzzy?
It already is. There are already robots that act on the directives of the Board of Governors. They act on the directives of these boards, these commissions. And it's very few of them who are actually directing, such as Dianne Feinstein John Holdren, the science czar. You've got, let me see, the Senate Judiciary Committee is the majority of the directives. You've got John Cornyn, Dianne Feinstein, Barbara Boxers, such as these folks who are sitting on all of the commissions, all of the councils.
Software system would decide on legislation through online vote by constituency. Now this, I think, could play right into this plan, you know, Congress would like to see implemented where everybody has to have an online ID. The California tech startup wants to replace Congress. Okay. With software system that decides how to vote on every bill according to public opinion. Well, say the startup place a vote envisions Americans voting on legislation through their software system and is currently running two candidates for Congress, both software engineers.
Yeah, that's
who,
funny.
Who vowed to vote according to the tallies recorded by the system.
Uh-huh.
That's just another way to garner your consent. Right.
It's the same thing they have now. The Delphi survey, okay, that's one of the techniques. Consensus reality, trending is one of the techniques already. They've already got that in play, and the sheeple don't even realize it. You know, every time you click on, you know, here we are, we're teaching public law, we're teaching all of these things, we're showing you the laws, we're telling you, you know, if you want to see it, go to yale.edu.law, blah, 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 blah. But the thing is that the sheeple are out there clicking around on Family Guy and South Park and all of these fun things, farming on Facebook and all of these things. That's what's trending. Well, those trends ended up facilitating various articles put out by your government, such as Homer gets a tax cut. So here they are, they call you Homer Simpson because that's what's trending. That's what you act like. And so that's what they're going to talk to. That's what they're going to interact with, is Homer Simpson. If you act like Homer Simpson, you're going to be treated like Homer Simpson. So you might want to consider, you know, that everything that you do on the internet is already put into the cloud. It's already trending. And when, you know, what really makes me sick is when, you know, the Kardashians are trending, or you know, what else is stupid that's trending? I mean, anywhere. You can go to any news site and see what's trending. And it's usually the most retarded things, because that's what people are participating in. That's what they want to see. They want to see all of this entertainment. They don't want to see the truth. They want to shy away from the truth. And that's, of course, that's not going to raise the bar. That's going to keep you in the same position you're already in.
Yeah, so it's a position they want to put you in is even much worse. People say no, no, no to GMO. Congress says yes, yes, yes. We'll figure out a way to pass laws to keep it in place.
Right, because you have sheeple out there protesting. You have sheeple out there, you know, not doing anything about what's happening to them. They're asking Congress, please stop attacking me. They're not telling Congress, stop funding Monsanto. How do you tell Congress to stop funding development grants in Monsanto? Stop paying them. Stop patronizing them. If you don't like it, stop patronizing it. You don't ask the wolf to stop, please stop eating the chickens.
Or more like it is to tell the wolf to stop eating you as he's biting into your leg, getting some nice chunky meat slabs there.
Right, injury.
So, yeah, this GMO crisis is, oh man, it's really sad to see that it's still going on. They're still slamming it down the farmers' throats, you know, and it's getting to be planting season here, and you know, many of the crops have already been planted, and I don't even know what they've been planting. And it's you know, the writing's on the wall for them shutting down the food supply with all these meat recalls lately. Let's see, walnuts was included in that. You know, and also they're prepositioning the water crisis. They're creating the water crisis and saying, oh, we've got a water crisis. And, you know, but do they stop the fracking? Do they stop all the corporations from polluting the waters?
Nope, because everybody's patronizing it. And they think it's a good idea to sell carbon credits between corporations. Corporations are dickering over a human life and selling each other carbon credits. Oh, today you can have the carbon credit. No, it's mine today. I want the carbon credit. What the heck are you patronizing? What the heck are you doing? How about a break real quick, Bo, so I can load up some stuff without making a whole bunch of clicking noises.
Okay.
Okay, we'll be back in a moment, folks.
Okay, we are back. This is the Public Law Radio Show that is run on No Borders and also on, what's the other station?
Tirnasaor.com. And No Borders can be found at noborders.co.uk. And just click on the radio player and it should play. If it doesn't play right away, just refresh. It should play.
All right, we'll just try to hammer through some of this news here and discuss it as it pertains to what's going on. John Kerry agrees to testify on Benghazi attack. And he says he's willing to testify before the House Oversight Panel investigating the deadly 2012 attack in Benghazi, Libya. Yes, an appearance that should make subsequent testimony before a newly formed select committee unnecessary, the State Department said Friday. In a letter to Chairman Daryl Issa, a clearly annoyed department, said diplomatic responsibilities prevent Kerry from testifying on May 29th, the date of committee subpoena. The department offered alternative dates for June 12th or June 20th. The department says Kerry's testimony should be sufficient and would remove any need for the secretary to appear before the select committee to answer additional questions.
It's just beautiful. That's what you call the marriage feast, Revelation 19. The clearinghouse is going to testify about the last clearinghouse discharging congressional bankruptcy by maintaining war crimes and civil war risks, which it's very interesting how this all comes down. Num, 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 num.
Yeah, and a somewhat related story. He has no idea, and he's touting off about the climate change propaganda that he's perpetuating. He doesn't even have his figures right. In a recent story here, if I can find that headline again, and it's just funny. Confused Kerry can't even get temperature data right in most recent climate speech. You know, of course he doesn't know any of the facts. He just knows the propaganda that he's got to be pushing. So, comments or questions?
It's very profound to see one clearinghouse go after the last clearinghouse, and now that there's a new policy and a new judge in town and stuff like that. I don't have the words anymore. It's just absolutely awe-striking with what's coming down the pike.
Yeah, we got We got, you know, of course, everybody loves that shirty roundup headline news I do. We got a big one here. Former Philly judge, Barry charged with corruption. This is, of course, in Philadelphia at the Philly.com website. Harrisburg, Pennsylvania state prosecutors filed corruption charges against a retired Philadelphia judge on Thursday for allegedly using the public resources of his judicial office to run his private real estate company. Oh, and it ties right in with the real estate thing. How do you like that?
That was formerly their function. Judges always are right there. Coldwell Bank, realtors, the development grants, everything. It all funnels right down to the little guy that's putting his hand on those signatures there, authorizations.
Yeah, Willis Berry Jr., 72. He's not a spring chicken. Turned himself in to face one felony count each of theft of services and conflict of interest. Okay? So, how you like them apples? Get on in there, little Shirley.
Beautiful. We were talking about racial hygiene this week and how we do not agree with the former policy. And, of course, voila. Attorney General files charges against operators of a local mental health care facility. Oklahoma City today, May 23rd. Attorney General Scott Pruitt has filed charges in Oklahoma County District Court against the operators of a mental health care facility, the operators of Central Oklahoma Behavioral Health, or COBHS, are charged with multiple charges, including Medicare fraud. John Michael Donetti, 50, of Oklahoma City, and Angelique Marie Williamson, 39, of Choctaw, were each charged with five counts of Medicaid fraud, one count of identity theft, one count of conspiracy to commit Medicaid fraud, one count of engaging in transactions involving unlawful proceeds, and one count of conspiracy to engage in transactions involving unlawful proceeds. According to the charges, Donetti and Williamson allegedly billed in excess of $289,000 FRNs and fraudulent claims to the Oklahoma Health Care Authority, or OHCA. Donetti is a licensed professional counselor, and Williamson is a behavioral health rehabilitation specialist. Both were tasked with operations at COBHS. During an investigation by the Attorney General's Medicaid Fraud Control Unit, agents found false claims by COBHS for Donetti's services that claimed he was working more than 24 hours in one day and billing for false claims under another employee's identity. Williamson paid clinicians for work they performed, but allegedly dispensed the fraudulently gained money to herself and Donetti. If convicted, Donetti faces up to 50 years in prison and or fines totaling more than $1.5 million FRNs. William faces up to 33 years in prison and or fines of more than $339,000 FRNs. Get on in there.
Wow. All right, over here on Cleveland.com. In Cleveland, Ohio, former Richmond Heights Superintendent Robert Moore II was sentenced to a year in prison for extorting money from a daycare operator. District's former Director of Building and Grounds Richard Muse was ordered to spend 10 months in prison for his role as Moore's bagman. Cuyahoga County Common Pleas Judge Shirley Strickland Saffold ordered the men to prison following a two-hour hearing. Former officials pleaded guilty April 30th to corruption-related charges involving payments Moore accepted in February from a daycare operator who ran a private business from the district's elementary school. Bobby Jordan, president of the school board, told Saffold that superintendents are not just leaders of school districts but role models. He said Moore stole money from a district that is swimming in debt. Well, of course they all are. We said the district has a budget of $13 million and faces a shortfall of about $800,000. Yeah, they all run in debt.
It's beautiful.
It's congressional debt now, though. We slammed it back on their side of the fence and took it off of yours because, you know, congressional bankruptcy is now just that. Congressional bankruptcy. It's their bankruptcy to offset. And they're going to do it by using the surety, which is not human beings any longer.
And this is beautiful. I love the terminology they're using. They actually said that they were using bagmen, which is a nice little mafia term there. It's nice to see that they're actually saying, look, they're shaking people down. Hint, hint. From the DenverPost.com, this is today as well. Mayor of Woodland Park arrested as suspect in sex assault on a child. The mayor of Woodland Park has been arrested on suspicion of sexually assaulting a child. David J. Turley was arrested Friday morning on suspicion of sexual assault of a child by one in a position of trust, according to a Woodland Park Police Department media release. Turley has been booked in the Teller County Jail. His bond is set at $10,000. FRN's Woodland Park and Colorado Springs police investigated the case, the release said. Investigators suspect there is only one victim in this case. Turley, a longtime resident of Woodland Park, was elected to his first term as mayor in April of 2012. In October, he was injured in a motorcycle accident, suffering severe upper body injuries, including broken ribs. As part of his platform during the mayoral run, Turley highlighted his, quote, current successes with various youth programs within our community, end quote, according to a political website. Turley, who has coached youth baseball, mentioned working with youth in local schools within the RE2 school district and perhaps establishing a, quote, mayor's team of youth advisors, end quote, as part of his platform. Goodbye, pedophile. Goodbye, goodbye. Farewell in your endeavors as you, Job, get everything you deserve.
Yeah, got another one here. Las Vegas family and marriage counselor indicted on charges linked to soliciting minor for sex. Let's see here. Indicted by a federal grand jury on felony charges tied to an attempt to solicit a minor for sex. Ian Alexander Pinecombe, 45, was charged earlier in the week with coercion and enticement of a minor, possession of child pornography, and receipt of distribution of child pornography. He faces arraignment Wednesday before U.S. Magistrate Judge George Foley Jr. An undercover Henderson police detective found a Craigslist ad by Pinecombe seeking sex with a woman, according to a criminal complaint filed after his May 2nd arrest. Authorities say Pinecombe included a nude photograph of himself. A detective posing as a 13-year-old girl exchanged sexually explicit emails and text messages with Pinecombe, complaint says. And so Henderson police arrested Pinecombe at a shopping center parking lot. Oh, good. They made a little spectacle out of it.
Good.
Where authorities said he thought he was to meet with the 13-year-old girl for a sexual encounter. Case is being investigated by the FBI, Henderson Police Department, and Internet Crimes Against Children Task Force.
Good. Good. Caught him red-handed. Good. From CNN.com, Fox News anchor Greg Jarrett jailed after airport incident. Now, this is... I'll just read it. Fox News anchor Greg Jarrett spent a dozen hours in jail after being arrested on charges of interfering with a police officer at the Minneapolis-St. Paul International Airport, officials said. Jarrett, 59, was belligerent and uncooperative with police officers who responded to a report Wednesday that he was drunk at an airport bar, according to an airport spokesman, Patrick Hogan. Quote, he is dealing with serious personal issues at this time, and quote, a Fox News spokeswoman said in an email to CNN on Thursday. Jarrett was released from the Hennepin County Jail on a $300 bond early Thursday, according to jail records found online. He has a June 6th court date on a misdemeanor charge of obstruction of the legal process and interfering with a peace officer, the record said. TV Newser, a website that covers the television news industry, reported on May 12th that Jarrett was taking time off from his weekend anchor duties on Fox quoting the network as saying he had, quote, requested time off for personal reasons, and Fox obliged, end quote. Jared joined Fox News 12 years ago and has most recently co-anchored on weekend shows. Quote, a date at which Greg might return to air has yet to be determined, end quote, the Fox News statement to CNN said. Now, this is, of course, political cannibalism. He's going through everything that Job always goes through. And, of course, he's having personal issues. And it just gets better and better for Job after this point in time. You know, his house burns down, family leaves him, criminal activity, institutionalization, hospitalization, whatever is most efficient for judicial economy.
Former North Kingstown attorney arrested for unlawful appropriation of 40,000 U.S. Federal Reserve notes. And state police say that back in August of 2010, while 65-year-old James Currier was representing a client, he deposited a $46,291.11 check from Allstate into his client account and later withdrew the funds for his own use. Currier was disbarred in Rhode Island in March of 2013 after the disciplinary board found he had violated rules of professional conduct when he failed to promptly deliver his client funds she was entitled to receive, commingled those funds with his own, and misappropriated those funds for his own personal use. He was charged with unlawful appropriation, over 1,000, and arraigned at Providence Superior Court. He was released on $15,000 personal reconnaissance bond, I think it's supposed to say at the end. That was from ABC6.com. So get on in there, Mr. Attorney.
Absolutely. There's no other, there's no greater joy in these things at this time after watching and watching all of these things year after year, day after day, moment after moment, as they got away with all of these things until now. From the IndyTannel.com, prosecution sought over councilwoman's recording. From Evansville, Indiana, the head of Indiana's State Board of Accounts says he wants an Evansville city councilwoman prosecuted for releasing audio recordings she secretly made of a meeting with state auditors. Democratic Councilwoman Stephanie Burkerhoff Riley released on Monday the recording from a March conference between city officials and auditors reviewing city finances. She says the public should know about the, quote, failure, end quote, of Republican Mayor Lloyd Winicky's administration to balance the city's payroll account. State Examiner Paul Joyce tells the Evansville Courier Press that such conferences with auditors are supposed to be confidential, as changes could be made before the final audit report is released. State law says a public official found to have interfered with a state auditor must give up that position. Okay, sheeple, did you hear that? The business administration that you are told is just for you, special you, is actually confidential until they get all of the numbers right. Heads up here. Keep patronizing them.
Yeah. Well, lots of news here about the mainstream media dying. I think it ties into that Fox News anchor getting cannibalized there. Because people are even starting to turn it off, even though it's rammed right down their throat. I mean, I don't know what else to say about that. I mean, you keep getting caught in lie after lie after lie and propaganda after propaganda. You know, who wants to watch that or, you know, let alone pay for it? No wonder the newspapers are all dying. I think they're only still around, you know, via
private funding.
Yeah, private funding, which private means it's corporations, and corporations are your government through articles of incorporation.
Absolutely. And the most profound was recently at that correspondence dinner that quote Obama threw. That was put on as a display paid for by HBO. HBO was the one producing it. So it's no longer the federal dollars going into that, since their funding was all cut. It's HBO privately funding that. And of course, we warned everybody, if you participate, if you pay, if you donate to, if you give money or otherwise aid and abet the known enemy of humankind, what happens, Bo?
Well, choose,
choose your way of execution according to civil death.
There you go, I guess. I mean, you know, I like how you pointed out yesterday on your show that all those new arrests out of New York, 71 people, I believe it's up to rabbi, cop, nurse, among those arrested in the child porn bust. New York City police and federal authorities arrested at least 70, I think it was 71 the last I heard, was being billed as one of the largest online child pornography busts ever. And although that's big news and it's good stuff, you pointed out how these are just the fall guys, and the people at the top of the food chain are just throwing them in the pile, you know, to try to take the focus off of them.
Right. And it comes down to these guardian ad litems. Guardians, county conservators, are the ones actually tricking out the children. They're the ones that are selling them to juvenile justice. They're the ones that are selling them to psychiatrists. They're the ones that are selling them to therapists and others that lice the child's mind. And it's absolutely foul. But as we saw within the last 2 weeks, guardians are being charged and held accountable. I mean, there was a female guardian that was given more time than the male, of course. Because it's the female is the main perpetrator of child sex trafficking and female sex trafficking, as well as the male slave labor market, according to the UN report on human trafficking of 2009, anyway. And more's coming, and you won't know when it's going to hit you, and it might not be that you'll be nailed for child sex trafficking. You might find yourself the victim of a one-car accident or whatever is necessary to remove you from the ability to harm any more children. And that's the way everything's going to go down. And again, Matthew 6, there's no tooting horns or anything. All I want is the removal of the predator. It doesn't matter how you remove them. From the LATimes.com, ex-Covina middle school coach sentenced in child porn sex case. A Covina middle school teacher who molested adolescent boys and was grooming one of his students to be a victim before he was caught has been sentenced to more than 23 years in federal prison. John David Boyle, 52, of Glendora, teacher and athletics coach at Royal Oak Middle School, has been targeting boys for 30 years before his arrest last June, prosecutors said. He was sentenced to 23 and a half years in prison. Boyle was arrested in his classroom on a weekend last year when he met someone who he thought was a fellow pedophile who wanted to watch child pornography and engage in sexual acts. But the person was actually a federal agent who arrested Boyle and seized his laptop. Though Boyle was convicted of only 4 counts of inducing a minor into sex and producing, possessing, and distributing child pornography, prosecutors said in court documents that his laptop contained 3,000 pictures and 281 videos of child porn. Quote, he was certainly bold, and I think the court said it best in one word, horrendous, end quote, said Assistant U.S. Attorney of Violent and Organized Crime Nicholas Trutanich. He's a sexual predator who used his classroom to further his illicit sexual desires. Not only did he admit to grooming students, but he was caught in the classroom where he'd invited an undercover agent. Boyle had victimized a young male relative and had lured a different boy, 14, through an online chat room before molesting him in a park, prosecutors said. During the investigation, Boyle boasted to one person online that he had molested as many as 20 boys, Tutanich said. Now, Chertanich is going to be held accountable for downplaying the criminal activity, as well as cashing in on this child sex predator as well, as will the judge be, because it's not going to be tolerated anymore. First, you have to allow them to cannibalize each other. And that's what's being done now.
Well, the economy is getting so bad on their end. And this one comes out of the independent.co.uk. Italy includes cocaine, prostitution, and black market alcohol in GDP figures. Is that because, hey, it's looking too bad on paper, we got to try to make it look better here? Yeah. Is that maybe what that's about?
Yeah, that was like the actuary directives a few years ago. They said you got to stop posting about the incidence rates per zip code, because they didn't want anybody realizing that everybody's on a grid and it actually occurs per zip code. It's not a personal agenda, it's a business model. That's funny. So you gotta spot it with something else now, huh?
The Italian government has announced it will include revenues from prostitution and illegal drug sales to its gross domestic product figures.
It still falls in line with consumption.
The change in methodology complies with new EU rules requiring member states to record the value of all activities that produce income, including the production of consumption of drugs, prostitution, and black market alcohol and cigarette sales.
Right. It's still that one-third of consumption activity. One-third is in taxation.
They're just being more honest about it now, right? Is all.
Right.
The move could boost the country's finances by as much as 2%. According to the European Statistics Office,
yeah.
Eurostat,
and
help Prime Minister Matteo Renzi tackle the country's deficit.
Yeah.
Last week, official figures showed that the Italian economy unexpectedly contracted in the first quarter. Italy's GDP fell by 0.1% in the first 3 months of the year from the previous quarter, and by 0.5% from the same period a year earlier. Analysis polled by Reuters expected a 0.2% quarterly rise and a 0.1% annual fall.
This is funny because they're telling, okay, for all of the attorneys out there that are now in the shoot, prostitution is going to be part of the new GDP. Have fun! Woohoo!
The Bank of Italy estimates that the value of the criminal economy accounts for approximately 10% of the country's GDP. Italy also has a significant shadow economy, which by some estimates accounts for as much as 17% of GDP.
Oh my God, this is so funny, because before, you know, I was thinking, well, they can produce in various manners, but they're going to really ramp it up on these attorneys and enter them into the sex trafficking market. I can't wait. I cannot wait to see that. Prostitution is going to be part of it.
Yeah, and it, you know, again, it's everybody that evidence themselves to be a surety can be found to be in that shoot. For example, here, back to Denver again, at the Denver Post, Broncos T.J. Ward accused of throwing mug at strip club bartender.
Wow.
Okay, I mean, this is just basically he threw a temper tantrum. Because he asked for a non-alcoholic drink and he got that, and this bartender saw this bottle he smuggled in earlier. I guess they're hurting for money so bad, being a professional football player, you can't afford drinks at the bar. So he had his own hooch or whatever in a bottle, and he was getting like cokes, you know, filling up the, you know, making rum and coke or something like God. That. And she caught him on it, and and then he threw a temper tantrum and threw a drink at her or something like that. After,
so what the hell was he doing there?
I'll get down and read it as soon as the advertisements stop me from scrolling down.
That's funny.
Gosh, these advertisements are just. Man, we got to start holding them accountable for, like, advertisements. It's brutal to even get through some of these stories on the internet sometimes. It's just so bad. It's like advertisements everywhere. It's like...
There's no funding.
It's like Futurama. The advertisements are appearing in your brain.
It's funny.
Let's see here. Oh, gosh. Now, I'm tired of fighting your advertisements there.
Well, they lost all their funding. How else are they going to stay, you know, floating?
Okay, here it is. So, yeah, TJ Ward is accused. Stop already. My goodness. Ah, man. Now Internet Explorer has stopped working. I apologize for even using Internet Explorer. It's just this computer I use for the radio shows is just what I use for radio shows. And man. So my regular... Okay, I can't. I guess I can't
read
it.
We'll come back to it. Send me the link and then...
It's the one from the Denver Post. You got it. And
I'll find it
anyway. So it would be probably even have gotten to that level if he didn't have so many funds to extract from him because he's a professional football player, right? So, all right. Well, what else we got here?
It's just sad. I don't see it, but we'll come back to it.
It's not that big of a deal. It's just that another example of how they're redistributing people that have
money.
any money left to redistribute, which right. isn't us anymore. The attorneys have extracted about everything out of us, and the big reason in the push to get this all done over this last couple years has been to, prevent what happened in Poland after the Bayer Corporation came in and, you know, Germany basically then was presented as the Bayer Corporation. They indemnified Poland. And you know... Once you're indemnified, it's not looking too good because that's when they just come in and off you, like right. Hitler did.
Right. And so what happened was, in this case, and you can find the entire case that Bo brought against them at chooseyourside.org. And what had happened was, ultimately, the United States Incorporated and all associates, all Confederate states, all of the criminal enterprise was indemnified to discharge congressional bankruptcy. Same exact same thing that they've been doing to human beings. They've had that in place since the 1802 Indemnification Convention, adhering to all of these corporate policies. That was the reason for each state constitution, which were actually enablement acts. You know, that worked so well. Hitler came in 1933, of course, with his act of enablement and indemnified Poland, but that came from the Bayer Corporation. And you can find that at the World Courts, maintained by Congress, of course, and it's actually the case called the Company at Churzow, Churzow. That being said, enough is enough. We don't have to harp on it any longer.
Yeah, it's just, you know, to show you what they put humanity through. I mean, I got another one that they basically, prison guards suspected of boiling mentally ill inmate to death. Security cameras malfunctioned after placing him in scalding shower.
Right.
It's an investigative report from the Miami Herald. Okay. And it profiles a prison in Miami-Dade County where employees have been accused of abusing mentally ill inmates for sport.
Right.
And this guy was in there on a commercial crime, too. I think it was a drug-related thing.
Right.
And you read the story, didn't you?
Yeah, we covered it last night on the show. I know you came in the second hour, but I did cover that in the first hour. But we really didn't talk about it last night after you come on, if you have anything to add, because it just made me really sick.
Well, it just shows the kind of a treatment you can expect when, you know, these privateers come in and pick you up for some commercial crime and, you know, throw you in there. It's like that 300-pound prison guard that slammed that 110-pound guy that was in there on some misdemeanor and killed him. I mean, once you get behind those bars, I mean, if you weren't property before, you sure as heck are then.
Right, and we were talking about that, you know, during the first hour, I was, and what has occurred up until this point in time, of course, that happened back in 2012. That poor man was considered a useless bread gobbler, and they got rid of him, and that's the bottom line. It said he had mental health issues, which of course is in line with the 1924 Racial Integrity Act and the related fallout. Of course, the 1933 Acts of Enablement, Hitler's, you have the Margaret Sanger eugenics program, and the psychiatrist behind Hitler. And that's actually, you can read that book. It's called The Psychiatrist, The Men Behind Hitler by Thomas Roeder. And of course, you can find that on our YouTube videos, as well as on my wall. I try to keep that in the forefront because of the implications of all of this, because it's always been psychiatrists running this business. Psychiatry creates in the mind the necessity for mental health services after they dehumanize human beings in the mind and allow you to be pit up against each other, which of course, thanks to Bo, is no longer tolerated, and there is a new policy in place, and that's the saddest thing, because, you know, of course, during the break, I was reading through the Skype messages and things, and you know, there's people arguing, you know, why do we have to choose, you know, and justifying why they're still patronizing that thing, and I continuously attempt to maintain, you know, I am not your judge. I'm here to show you what happens if you go either way. It's up to you whether you're going to go either way. It's not up to me. I'm not going to drag you away from it, although I can present to you why you should leave that other daddy. And
well, that's the kind of thing I'm trying to present all the time, you know, that these people think that they can fix government because it just got broken and the founding fathers had it right to begin with. And no, the point of the matter is, if you read what's going on, that it's working exactly as it was set up to work.
Right.
And commercial crimes and all the stuff they're going to do to you as Job, it's right there in the organic constitution, if you want to call it that.
Right. And the worst part is, I'm sorry.
So you just don't want to be a surety. I mean, that's the bottom line. And it was unlawful on its face to throw human beings into the holding corporation and use them to back their congressional bankruptcy.
Right,
in the first place.
It's all a test. It is all a test. And as an example, during Bolshevik Russia, which was the first model of feminism, and right now I'll say I am speaking to all females. I love you. I love you beyond all measure. My entire walk is because I love you beyond all measure. Bolshevik Russia, when they employed feminism stemming from the French Revolution, providing for the rights of, quote, females. The word gender means stock. race, species. You are nothing more to that daddy than an animal on a farm. This farm relies on the female's consent. Not the male's, the female's. Your estate has been held in chattel since the Coronation Charter, which is otherwise known as the Charter of Liberties. When your use is met, you are killed in all known variants. I am so close in proximity to Bonnie, to Edna, to Sonia Marie. And each time I watch as these females are choosing the medical industry, and each time I witness their deaths, and my hands are tied, only because these females are choosing that daddy. My entire life has been given to you, that you wake up. Because, and Jesus taught us this. He said, my children perish, my people perish for ignorance. And I interact with you every day. Every day I say the same thing. Get away from it. Stop patronizing it. And I hear the same thing. What if? What if? What if? What if? What if? But I. No, I can't. No, I can't. Not right now. Not right now. Not till later. In my own relativity, I've watched this time and time and time again. Statistically, 42 females each and every day are dying because of prescription medication. That is the intent of these prescription medications. It kills you slowly. It kills you while you feel good. It makes you feel good. You get to dumb up, dope up. And ultimately you drowned in your own fluids.
Well, yeah, as I got to see firsthand with my mother and now, you know, Edna was very... She was, to the maid of honor at my mom's wedding. And Edna Mae went through the same ordeal as my mom, with a slight variation, and these drugs that they're using to kill people in lethal injections are the same ones given my mom and Edna and under the guise of helping them. And, you know, I mean, there was nothing I can do. They signed up for that stuff and consented to it.
And they wouldn't hear me then either. They wouldn't hear me. I was going out of my way to talk to Mom. And I watch you every day as you don't hear me. You come up with other justifications not to go and patronize your own house. But the ultimate is it kills you. It doesn't have a discriminatory anything. The end result of your existence is the same death. The same use of your body until it wears out. And again, you know, leaving the farm is coming to an end. All of these things are coming to an end, and I've... Revelation says 50% of the female population is going to be decimated in this. It says right in Revelation that one goes and one stays. Hey, I think I'm being selfish because I interact with you every day. And I don't want to lose you. And I pray that you're here, but you don't hear. And so, I have to turn away so I don't see this anymore because it's killing me. And I'm not going to subject myself to this much longer because I can't do this. I'm not going to be tortured on your behalf. I'm not going to carry your cross because that was all that was asked of you. We've done everything we could. I'm sorry for getting emotional, but Edna was so quick. She was fine at that week of Mom's funeral. I'm not watching it anymore. I don't have to. I'm not going to choose to because it's your choice. I don't think I'm being hard or evil or anything because lost sheep are lost. They don't have the knowledge. They don't have the ability. They don't have any of the keys or anything. But the human beings that are choosing this now are not lost. The ones that I've been interacting with and speaking to and trying to reach. They don't want to hear. They don't want to see. Again, I'm not willing to subject myself to any more. I've suffered. I did what I was supposed to do. I believe I carried your cross long enough. I'm not going to do it anymore. From the WJLA.com, Nathaniel Morales of Covenant Life Church convicted of sexually abusing young boys. This is another action of the system, pedagogy, removal of the firstborn son. This is Rockville, Maryland. Nathaniel Nate Morales, a former youth camp leader at Covenant Life Church in Gaithersburg, was convicted Thursday of sexually abusing three young boys between 1983 and 1991. A 12-member jury found Morales, 56, guilty on two counts of sexual offense in the second degree and three counts of sexual abuse of a minor. Tears of joy could be heard from victims and their family members as the verdict was read. Quote, I started crying. It was overwhelming to know that the struggle, the fight, the 25 years of trying to bring this forward was worth it. And, quote, victim Jeremy Cook, now a married father of three, said. Cook, who Morales abused roughly 50 times during his teenage years, was surprised to see his abuser's reaction or lack thereof. Quote, he just sat there. There was no emotion, no reaction, nothing, nothing at all, end quote, Cook recollected. Among the crowd of victims and their family members was a woman named Pam Palmer. Quote, we thought we were the only ones. We thought this was some unique tragedy that had happened to our family, and yet we found out it happened to many, many families, end quote, Palmer stated. While Palmer acknowledges Morales' sadistic behavior, she believes Covenant Life Church is partly to blame. Palmer, who attended the mega church for 23 years, says her daughter, now 24, was abused by a male teenage member during the 1990s. Only 2 years old at the time, Palmer claims the church's pastoral team tried to cover up her daughter's abuse. Quote, one of the pastors told us, don't go to the police, end quote, Palmer remarked. Quote, they had a lot to protect. They had money, power, and prestige, end quote. Palmer, however, contacted investigators who pursued charges against her daughter's teenage attacker. I just had to do something. I felt like I couldn't live with myself if I didn't, Palmer said. How can you walk away from innocent children being abused and do nothing? Palmer says Covenant Life Church has a long-standing reputation of bearing sex abuse allegations. In fact, during Morales' trial this week, public defender Alan Drew drilled former pastor Grant Lehman while on the stand. Drew, quote, "Did you have an obligation to report the alleged abuse?" End quote. Lehman, "I believe so." Drew, quote, "And you didn't?" Lehman, quote, "No." Montgomery County State's Attorney John McCarthy says his office cannot prosecute anyone unless crimes are reported to police. Quote, "I think we've come to realize that's not the right way to deal with these matters," end quote, McCarthy stated in response to how Covenant Life handled the Morales allegations. Now, this is common practice up until now. I want everybody to realize here, if they already haven't, that under the public law, there is no statute of limitations. Everyone will be held accountable for their works.
Oh, and they're just hurting right now. You can see it. I mean, they're cannibalizing each other here. It's another goodie here. People's Bounty. Tea Party Group offers $1 million bounty for evidence of IRS corruption. Well, the Tea Party's run by an attorney, which I uncovered in another story earlier. So, again, this is Congress blaming Congress. If you want to look at it in the actual reality of things. This is mostly a video, too, unfortunately, over to xrepublic.tv. San Diego Police Department missing $1 million in funds.
Oh, no. Jeez. Yeah, gasp.
Yeah. San Diego. Police Department was seeking an audit to determine what happened to $1 million seized from the drug runners and other criminals. The other criminals besides themselves, I mean, I guess, right? Yeah. The audit request comes after local media noted that police submitted a report to the federal government in 2010 that showed a closing balance of $1,153,426 in seized assets and closing balance of $153,426 a year later with no explanation as to how $1 million was spent. Funds were passed on to SDPD by U.S. Treasury agencies. And so, I don't know, I'm just guessing, but I think the municipality was hurting for funds and just kind of siphoned it off there, or what?
Yes, it's very interesting.
But yeah. The federal state only gives the national state or the municipalities like 7% back.
Right.
So all these tickets and everything that they're writing at the county levels, your county's only getting 7% of that. The rest of it goes to the pirates at the federal state level.
Absolutely. We're going to take a break here, folks. We'll be right back.
A wee bit of echo there on that wee bit of Scottish song.
Sorry about that. Welcome back to the Public Law right here with Bo and Tammy.
I better not talk in accents. I'm just going to tick people off over there.
So we're going to go.
I mean no harm. Have to have a little bit of fun here or I go insane.
And you are listening to No Borders Radio. At noborderradio.co.uk, as well as simulcasting tonight on Tirnasaor. And again, we're running over, but we want to make sure and include everything and as we can. I mean, now that we've got the time, might as well use it to the most efficient. And I know that you had a couple stories you wanted to go over before we end the show tonight, and we'll just do it.
Oh, yeah, we were talking about the Tea Party here as we went to break. Now, this ties in also with this big story that has been run in the mainstream recently about Senator Cochran's ill wife and the Tea Party are charged with conspiring with bloggers to take photos of her.
Yeah, that's not agents or anything. They just call them bloggers. But then again, you know, Obama came out and said he's got a bunch of agents. So let's just call it what it is. Agents.
Yeah, I thought this guy was an attorney. I was reading from a different story earlier. Well, let me just go through it here. Conservative blogger Clayton Thomas Kelly, 28, of Pearl, was arrested last week on allegations he took the photos of Rose Cochran on Easter Sunday without her permission at the nursing home where she was lived for 13 years for dementia. Okay. So, investigators say a Mississippi Tea Party official and two other men arrested Thursday. Now, this Tea Party official, I had read in another news source, is an attorney.
Right.
And he conspired with, the two other men arrested Thursday conspired with this guy to use photographs of U.S. Senator Thad Cochran's ill wife to push allegations that the longtime Republican senator was involved in an inappropriate relationship with another woman. Okay.
And absolutely. Shovel your wife off to a nursing home and you can do anything you want, right? It's not for better or for worse or to death do us part. It's when it's convenient to a politician psychopath.
Yeah. Yeah, so... So it looks like three are arrested on this deal here so far. And, again, it's just more signs of political cannibalism.
Absolutely.
And it makes no difference if it's Tea Party, Republican, Democrat, Independent. Congress is Congress, okay? Get your mind past that. It doesn't matter what kind of a face you paint on that Congress critter, they are your transgressors. It comes from their own etymology of language. Con with, and then gress is short for transgression.
Right.
Okay? You're
a walk.
You people that are still patronizing and voting for these things to rule over you, or you're voting for your own demise, essentially, because they're always writing all these laws and stuff to feed off of humanity. And, you show me a bill or a law or an act that went through Congress, and I'll show you where the bottom line is. The human being gets, the harm perpetuated against it with such a legislative action.
And my favorite part is, we talk about political cannibalism, and we say that word over and over again. That is Revelation 19, the marriage feast. This is a feast. Cannibalism is a feast. They're eating each other. And this is not a time to be sad over these things. It's a marriage feast, for goodness sakes. And this is how it's supposed to be. It's beautiful.
Yeah, and and so many things come to light in the story. I mean, you have got the attorney who was, I believe they put a $250,000 bond on him as well, didn't they?
Absolutely, and it's all over. I mean, this is like, holy cow, and senators left and right, and more every day. It's like we said, we can't keep up on Leaving the Farm or on Bone Rocco, and even the public law, it's coming in faster than we can even deal with things. Just celebrate these things. It's absolutely profound.
Okay, back at philly.com here. Headline reads, felony charges, primary challengers, and now a lawsuit for State Senator Leanne Washington. And she got plenty of charges today, it says. Well, this is May 21st now, but, okay, a couple days ago. Two Democrats are seeking to derail Washington's bid for re-election to the 4th District seat while she fights felony corruption charges filed in March. Pile on another challenge. Washington's former chief of staff is suing her, claiming she wrongfully terminated and defamed him while violating the state's whistleblower law. Sean McRae, who also sued the Senate Democratic Caucus and a grand jury witness in an investigation by the state attorney general's office that resulted in Washington being charged with two felonies on March 12th. McRae repeats in this lawsuit, or in his lawsuit, filed Friday in Montgomery County, the raging response he said Washington gave when he repeatedly told her to stop using state tax dollars to fund an annual political fundraiser that doubled as her lavish birthday party. I am the blankin' senator, and I do the blank what I want, how I want, and ain't nobody gonna change me, McRae said, she told him.
Yeah, it looks like you're having a really nice time with your works in action, too. You know, we covered this back when this originally occurred, you know, when it was first coming out that she used these monies for her birthday party and how cocky she was. And she's been taken down a few steps, hasn't she?
Yeah, taking her a few steps lower here in this report. McRae also accuses Washington of ordering him to not hire a woman because she was a lesbian and of making homophobic comments about employees.
That's your function. Division. Division. Divide and conquer. Make sure that you get the sheeple citizens all riled up and hating each other, because then you can cash in on it, right? I mean, that was a former policy. It's over now, though. Sad day for you. But at least she got to celebrate her last birthday in style.
Yeah. Well, again, people, I mean, you know, they're just think of the Senate that had all these slaves back in the day in Rome, you know, and they're living it up with nice servant provided baths and having their wine goblets filled on demand, and you know, the rest of their subjects are wallowing around in poverty and filth. And that's why I compare today to, you know, the same situation we had back in Rome.
Right. And this is the most beautiful, because throughout my own walk, you know, and experiencing all these things and witnessing all these things, you know, one of the most beautiful thoughts is her next birthday and her two for a dollar hot dogs from 7-Eleven celebration, rather than a lavish birthday she got herself used to off of the taxpayers' backs.
Let's see here. Child porn charge doesn't stop ex-Elgin lawmaker's state pension. And here's another example of that, I guess, huh? This is Springfield, Illinois. This is ChicagoTribune.com. Former state lawmaker who was accused of trading child pornography online has started collecting a state pension of nearly $15,000 a year, an amount he bumped up by purchasing credit for time he didn't work. Ex-Representative Keith Farnham, an Elgin Democrat, is the latest Illinois lawmaker to rake in pension checks while facing federal criminal charges. Former Democratic Representative Connie Howard of Chicago stands to reap $115,000 in the 2 years between her resignation and sentencing this summer.
Isn't that beautiful what you guys are patronizing, sheeple? Now, this is a senator that said he preferred the young ones. Remember, he likes them as young as 6 years old. He doesn't want to rape anybody that's over 12. These are your children he speaks of while you pay him a $15,000 a year pension. You might want to rethink who you're patronizing and what you're consenting to.
Yeah, and you know, it says here going on, it's allowed under state law. Former public officials don't automatically lose their state pension until sentencing is on the books. But, boy, I mean, if you're just a citizen and you get some kind of, even a false allegation, thrown in jail, you probably lose your job and you won't get any, pension there. And,
And if you do, it goes for your care while you're in prison.
right? Right. One watchdog group, however, says the pension checks of ex-lawmaker facing criminal charges should be frozen at the minimum monthly level while their cases play out. Okay.
Not even a minimum monthly level.
I mean, why don't they treat them like the plebeians and just throw them in jail until their case comes up?
Right.
They can take care of them right there.
Right. But they're sucking it dry. That's the flip side. Okay, so he's getting $15,000 a year.
Yeah.
Right now, this guy is on GPS monitoring. That runs an average of $1,500 a month. It's already gone. But the premise is that he's being paid to molest children still.
Exactly. I mean, I don't know how many ways to keep saying this, but by continually patronizing the system, thinking you're doing the right thing or not. I mean, you can't fix it. It isn't broken. It's working the way it was meant to work. And by continually to, continuing to just play into it as a patriot, citizen, you're allowing it to go on. So, I mean, the path is wide, but the gate is narrow. I've continually, shown that, and think it's fairly well evidenced now that we got this far with the case that in order to hold them accountable, I had to completely withdraw. I didn't use their paperwork to expatriate or any of their forms, that would just maybe be an illusion of getting out of the system, but you're still in the system. See, that's where so many of these people just miss the boat. I mean, they kind of get it.
And there's something else too that prompted you into action. Now, in the beginning, it wasn't just you were protecting. What had happened is that you realized what was going on. You realized what the sister kid trust was, what the use and the why is, and you made a conscious decision to protect others above yourself, right?
Well, that's what it comes down to, because
And that's what Jesus said. He said, take up your cross and follow me. He didn't say save your own butt. He actually said if you save your own life, you're going to lose it. And, I get emotional because you're going to lose your life. And again, I have to say that I'm choosing not to watch that anymore because it tortures me. And I'm done with the torture. I've done everything in my power to allow you the opportunity to make that conscious decision, and others are not making that conscious decision. Therefore, they want what's happening. They know what's going to happen, and they're making that choice to go to that side. When somebody says, "Well, it's not about the money. We're not doing this because we want money." Okay, you're not doing it because you're protecting anybody else either. You're staying in the situation you're in because you're what? Saving your own life. And that is what gets to me. Because you're guaranteed to lose it. And that to me is very, very sad that you would make that decision consciously.
Yeah, I guess the main thing that struck me was that the children are looking forward to a very bleak future with the way they're ramping up the depopulation program, and perpetuating genocide, you know, and it's all based off of the human trafficking model. It goes through that court system, which is really the bank, banking on human beings. I mean, you can see the writing on the walls in the entertainment with the movies and the propaganda and the predictive programming that they're putting into these movies with transhumanism. RoboCop, for example, and he's directly related into the police state. And you can see where they blur the lines of commercial crimes and harm upon human beings.
The Hunger Games.
Confusion. Right? It's confusing with fusion. It means they put it together so you don't know they're supposed to be separate. You know, you're so educated by the system that you think that stealing money from a bank is as bad as shooting somebody with a gun. And they're two different things.
Right.
It's just the attorney that is throwing them all under commercial crimes to cash in on all of them.
Right, and it really is the Hunger Games. And the Hunger Games is in your face, where children are pit up against other children and they fight for the death, to the death. What's the difference between having a child placed in the public school system and learning about colors, genders, cultural identities, sexual identities, all of these different concepts, in order to pit them against each other, in order to facilitate commerce? What is the difference between the Hunger Games and the Hunger Games? That's what this system is. You're placing children in public schools so that they can learn the difference. The difference. Disparity of the classes, racial disparity, maintaining that colors make somebody different, culture, religion makes somebody different. What is the difference between something as such as the Hunger Games or the new one, 100? What is the difference? There is absolutely no difference. And when you're teaching your children to climb a ladder of success, and tongue in cheek, on the other side, kick somebody else off that ladder, you know, just kick them on the head, climb over their backs, rise in succession, buy that stairway to heaven, that is not ascension, that goes along the same plane. That same plane of purgatory for the entire life or age of that product, that commercial product, a child. It's actually defined in Black's Law Dictionary as a commercial unit. The entire age of that commercial unit is that same plane through purgatory, although you're told you're rising on that ladder of success. Disparity just teaches everybody to be on that same plane, never ever ascending, never ascending, never reaching heaven, never reaching that, you know, paradise, always being degraded and classified, dehumanized, and the entire gamut of the 8 stages of genocide that starts with the educational indoctrination and teaching your children to compete with others based on these disparate conditions or statuses. And there has to be something in the mind that clicks at some point and says, well, we don't want to do that. No, we don't want to patronize that. And if it doesn't click, and you, in your mind, can view other human beings as objects, then away with you. Away from humanity, and that's what it comes down to.
Yeah, and you can see it directly with all the stories coming out recently about kids having guns pulled on them because they're building a treehouse. This one kid was trying to report a broken windshield on this car, trying to be a good Samaritan, and you know, these programmed sheeple call 911, the emergency system, and the cops come out and SWAT team this kid for trying to be a good Samaritan, telling his neighbors about somebody had broken these people's car window, and man, what happens? So you get punished for that stuff now, and they're breaking the kids because they're not delineating between, carefully, separating the kids out from adults. They're just lumping them all into they're the enemy.
Useless spray gobblers. And
that's policy handed down by the attorneys.
Right.
Congress.
But right here, right now, enough is enough. Now, we took over the exchequer. Now, we have given you plenty of opportunity to walk away from that other daddy. And it comes down to that other daddy now has to pay back what it owes the United States of being. And again, you're either with us or you're against us. If you're patronizing that thing, it is its opportunity. It has to come up with the money. It has to pay back the United States of being. And to do that, if you're patronizing it, and you're its subject, you're its thing, you're its object, it's going to use you to pay back the United States of being. There's no other option here. So, I mean, I don't know how else to say it, Bo. I don't have any other way to put it. I think I've explained it, 1,000 times.
Now, did you get a chance to watch that CNN video on the Al-Qaeda splinter group ISIS?
No. You and I were talking about it earlier, and I didn't have time before the show to actually watch that one.
Okay. Then let me give you a synopsis then, headline. And this is over on CNN's YouTube only. I can't find it on their main page on the web, CNN.com at this time. But headline reads, Mohammed Jamjoum reports on a new and even more brutal jihadi video from the Al-Qaeda splinter group ISIS, ISIS. And what it boils down to is, well, they were focusing on the video production of terror. Now they're presenting these videos from this splinter group ISIS that are more terrifying than Al-Qaeda doesn't want to even be associated with them, because they're showing live executions and people digging their own graves and all this brutal stuff, right? But they're comparing the videography to that of the mainstream production. And to me, it looks like more out of the playbook from the detailed staff reports, church committee book on foreign and military intelligence, however that title reads out. The title's so long I can never remember.
Right. It's the book 4 of the church committee staff report. So it's supplementary detailed staff reports on foreign and military intelligence.
Right. I can never get that committed to memory.
Well, and
but I mean, I've read through there, and of course you read thing on your YouTube videos. I think you take up a full 4 hours of YouTube to read it for everybody that doesn't want to read it.
Right. I just sent you a link, and in 2012, the FBI came out and said, well, it's us in the mainstream media.
Okay. Yeah, with the Guardian, ex-FBI informant with a change of heart. There's no real hunt. It's fixed, is the headline. Greg Monty describes how he pretended to be a radical Muslim in order to root out potential threats, shining a light on some of the Bureau's more ethically murky practices. And I guess what you got to understand, though, in reading through this muck, is that FBI's, federal, state, and
CIA
is just everywhere.
Right.
So they could be in the FBI. They're at the media. The Al Qaeda was created out of the same 1947 National Security Act. I mean,
even before that,
Al Qaeda even has to pay taxes to the IRS. So that doesn't tell you right there what's going on.
Right, and even before that, when it was the CIG, the Central Intelligence Group, Al Qaeda, simply in English, it means the base. And it was actually a presentation by the CIA during Bolshevik Russia. And it went hand in hand with the first model of feminism. And so this group was, they were actually presented as extreme masculists at that time. So they were the men's rights extremists at that time and promoting very, very bad agenda. Well, what happened was they began killing females and children, but they were told that those females and children, of course, through the action of feminism, were the perpetrators of all of these things against the male population. And it was the same thing that was occurring here. That is what the most important thing for us to go throughout this walk. You know, 8 years ago, when we realized what was going on again, you know, then we started coming out and saying, look, no, because the first model of feminism pissed off all of the males, and they took off. They went elsewhere. They left Bolshevik Russia. They left Nazi Germany. They left Poland. And what happened after that was all of the females and children, everybody on welfare, Social Security, state employee, federal employee, teachers, doctors, were decimated through the eugenics program. And but what maintained Al-Qaeda as the number one enemy of the state, and that continued until they, quote, you know, offed, what's his name? Osama bin Laden. Was because of that. At one point in time, they realized what they were actually doing, and they turned on their CIA handlers, and at that point in time, that's when they became enemy number one, public enemy number one. And ever since then, including up to the Bush administration, they were named and labeled as the bad guy, but it was never them. They turned on the CIA years and years ago, back during Bolshevik Russia and into Nazi Germany. But it was a great excuse for the United States Incorporated to continue the calling. And I'll read this story.
Right. Now, with the story with ISIS, though, the video report anyways, it's extremely interesting how they're pointing out the video graphics, the videography, and how the intelligence is created, and now they've created a bigger, badder, more scary version of itself for everybody to be afraid of, called ISIS.
Right.
And what we have to say under the public law, the bottom line is, if you harm a human being, you're going to be held accountable.
Absolutely.
That's the new schematic, and it's going to catch up with those that are, you know, carrying out these brutal attacks. In the end, you're going to be held accountable.
Right. And going on with that story that you started from theguardian.com, it was an FBI informant who came out, and I'll continue reading from where you left off. Craig Monte says he did not balk when his FBI handlers gave him the okay to have sex with the Muslim women under his undercover operation was targeting. Nor at the time did he shy away from recording the pillow talk. Quote, they said, if it would enhance the intelligence, go ahead and have sex, so I did, end quote. Monte told The Guardian as he described his year as a confidential FBI informant sent on a secret mission to infiltrate Southern California mosques. And for all those who live, quote, in the United States of America, this is the same Muslim extremist who walks around as a, quote, Shiite in other countries. This is the presentation. This is the presentation. And what you see as the Shiite Muslim that is contrary to the Sunni Muslim, all of these things, those are FBI agents. Those are CIA presentations. The CIA is a production company, and that is what it says in the Church Committee Reports, Book 4, Supplementary Detailed Staff Reports on Foreign Military Intelligence. Now, Book 2 is another interesting one. Because in Book 2 of the Church Committee Reports, of course, it maintains there that the FBI, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, was the entity that assassinated Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Book 4, going back to Book 4, says in there that it was JFK's brother who called out the assassination of JFK.
Robert Kennedy,
when he was Secretary of State. And he was the same clearinghouse as, of course, Hillary Clinton. The same clearinghouse as, of course, John Kerry, who's about to testify against Hillary Clinton to save his own butt. But these things are, I mean, this is absolutely horrifying because, you know, when the, quote, American citizen is shocked and their president is assassinated, they go into states of fear. And, of course, the FBI comes in and investigates. The FBI comes in to investigate themselves regarding the assassination that they perpetrated to maintain the clear and present danger. According to the clear and present danger doctrine, which then allows them to say, here I am, Moses, if you pay me taxes, I will protect you, because it's you all killing each other and stealing each other's wives and asses, which translates into the commandments. And this is the same presentation that has been maintained since Greece, since the inception of Polycrates, you know, as politics. Polycrates means to control or possess many. And that's the absolute. And all of these things are designed to get you to worship that other daddy, the Lord God itself, the same one that continuously creates man in another image. That is otherwise known as representation. Congress tells you that it is your representators, House of Representatives, and Senate. And Congress. And it's time to walk away from that other daddy, because this is its function. This is what it does.
Oh, they're representing you to death.
But, and now we go back to my little emotional tangent earlier. This story that I was just reading from TheGuardian.com, came out in 2012. The FBI said, hello, we are the extremists. The same year the CIA came out and said the underwear bomber is us. Book 4 of the Church Committee reports tells you that the CIA is a production company. Book 2 says the FBI assassinated Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. That's called notice. Okay? You, the sheeple out there that continually justify to me why you cannot walk away from that other daddy, you have notice that it kills you. If you continue to patronize it, that's not its fault. It told you and it tells you exactly what it is. That means that you're committing suicide. Now, I'm done trying to reach you. And I'm serious about that. I'm not going to wear your cross any longer. I've had enough of this burden. I did what I was supposed to do. We took over the exchequer. Now it owes the United States a being, those who want to not patronize that other daddy. Those of you with knowledge who continue to patronize it, get what you will get. You are willing. You are willing your own demise. I've cried over you long enough. I have hurt for you long enough. I've given my life for you long enough. And I am very sorry in these things. I'm sorrow-filled that you don't want to hear.
Well, let's see here. Just to round out the hour here, a regulator here says likely more than 13 deaths linked to GM switches. This has to do with that General Motors recall of that ignition switch that caused some fatalities. And for like a $1 part, and let's see, GM recalled 2.6 million older models, including the Chevrolet Cobalt and Saturn Ion, to replace faulty switches that can cause engines to shut off while driving, leading to a sudden loss of power steering and brakes and failure of airbags to deploy in a crash. Okay. GM has linked switch to 13 deaths and 35 crashes in these cars that were built sold between 2003 and 2010. GM spokesman Jim Kane on Friday said the GM recently informed regulators that it had identified about a dozen more crashes connected with the ignition switch in addition to the previous 35. In response from a query from Reuters, the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration said the final death toll associated with this safety defect is not known. But we believe it's likely more than 13.
Right. Now, for all you sheeple that want to continue patronizing the corporate governance, this is one of your government, GM. Now, if it kills you, if it injures you, brings you into law, who cashes in on that? And then much, much later, after they hit their capital gain mark and they increase their purse, they're going to let you know, oopsie, oopsie, we need to do something. Oh, you bad boy, you bad boy. And the sheeple citizens are going to come out and they're going to sue. And they're going to get 0.82%. 0.82%. This is the game. That is your corporate governance at work. GM didn't just have an accident GM didn't just now find out about its ignition switches. GM made a lot of money. And is now coming out, because their purse is full, to offer you 0.82%. Thank you for doing business with the United States Incorporated. Have a nice day.
Well, that's the whole thing about the Articles of Incorporation and how the corporations are brought into government, and the two function together through these articles. And, you know, if the attorneys knew this stuff was going on and didn't stop it from happening, you know, that's part of the business model, doesn't it? Fit? That you'd want to see more injuries and lawsuits being created out of this problem created by one of the corporations.
That's the name of the game.
For a dollar apart. Here's one story. I mean, when Rachel and Jacqueline Hawk's car suddenly veered out of control, shooting across the highway median and into an oncoming tractor trailer, killing the two women. The company that rented them their Chrysler PT Cruiser initially tried to claim the driver, 24-year-old Rachel, might have been either suicidal or on drugs.
God.
And that's how the courts will spin it to cash in. I mean, their system is not built on truth, so it's built on planned obsolescence. And for all their products, either a car or you, that they turn you into a product. I mean, it's in their better interest to
injure.
You know, to injure, to poke on you.
Injure. They cash in on the criminal industry, medical industry, psychological industry.
So of course they're going to keep this stuff hidden for a while so they can generate some more injuries and
until they top off the purse, and then they'll share with the sheeple 0.82%.
Yeah. So that's about how the U.S. Incorporated rolls. I don't know how many more ways to say it, but they're coming out with some disclosure in the media if you know what you're looking at.
So we're about to wrap this up, right? Going on the third hour?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I tell you. It's been a long week here.
Yeah, it has. So you want to go out with Seventh Son of a Seventh Son?
Fine.
Fitting? All right. Be well, everybody.